Ladies and gentlemen, good friends all, we greet you and welcome you to this memorial service in honor of the life, service, and leadership of Dr. John R. Silber, the 7th president of Boston University. In this hour, we hold several dear things in common as a community of one Boston University gathered this afternoon in memory and celebration. We have in common the experience of loss, the loss of a uniquely gifted person and leader. As one chapter closes, others open. We have in common our heartfelt shared condolences for the Silber family, as we did privately at Marsh Chapel on September 29th. So today in public, we offer our support, our thoughts, our prayers, and a willingness to offer any help that might be in our capacity to offer. We have in common a recognition, surely personal to each one, inevitably partial, probably still evolving, of the legacy, gift, and history together we receive and do inherit from the decades of Dr. Silber's leadership. We have in common a quickened sense of our own mortality, our fragility, our shared humanity, the daily gift of life itself, so precious, and also the honest reminder of the limits of life brought together in this hour. We enjoy a special recognition of the good gifts offered to Boston University by all of our 10 presidents, Presidents Warren, Huntington, Merlin, Marsh, Case, Chris Janer, Silber, Westling, Cobanian, and Brown. We have in common a deep gratitude to President Brown and our university leadership for their voice and witness today, and to our honored guests and speakers for their presence and remembrance. And we have in common a desire to remember John, to meet this moment of his passing, to match the moment, to master it, and so to be mastered by it. Last January, a couple of us had dinner with John. As we sat down, I saw a copy of a book of my sermons on the coffee table, a gift to him from Christmas, I believe. Ooh, I thought, here we go. I wonder, what will he say? Then, adding anxiety to anxiety, I noticed post-it notes placed through the volume, about 30 in total, I think. His response could not have been more generous. We talked that evening in earshot of the great Kantian themes of God and freedom and immortality. We talked about religious experience and how one enters another's personal, deep experience. In short, we talked about faith, hope, love, the things that last, count, and matter. And that, friends, is what we're doing this afternoon, talking about faith, hope, and love, the things that last, count, and matter. He did also say that evening, there are some typos in here. But then he quickly added, you can readily correct them in the second edition. And I thought, such hope, optimism, curiosity, a graceful word, and so a graceful memory. Today we shall offer our own remembrances. The service will proceed without further introduction or interruption, speaker to speaker, beginning with our 10th president, Dr. Robert A. Brown. As we listen and speak, reckon and recollect, perhaps we may hold in mind the verse of the psalmist who acclaims the lasting divine presence. Whither shall I go from thy spirit? Whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend to heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in Sheol, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there thy hand shall lead me, thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, let only the darkness cover me, and the light about me be as night, even the darkness is not dark to thee. The night is as bright as the day. For darkness is as light with thee. For darkness is as light with thee. President Brown.
We gather here today to celebrate the life and work of John Silber, Boston University's 7th president. We welcome friends from near and far, distinguished speakers, especially members of the Silber family. We offer our warmest appreciation for John's service to the university, and we extend our embrace to the family in a time of loss. We hope that this celebration will be of comfort, but also a tangible validation of our recognition of John Silber's extraordinary leadership of Boston University and his service to the city, the state, and the nation. Although John and I were from different generations, we share the common bonds of being from Texas and being associated with the University of Texas at Austin. One of the greatest things about growing up in Texas is that you get to spend the rest of your life teaching non-Texans how to speak English. I was reminded of this recently when I used the phrase, like a leech on a leg, to describe a tenacious advocate and experienced the curious expressions of people around me. A colleague who heard this made a wise crack about BU presidents from San Antonio in their locutions. John brought many Texas aphorisms to the Boston University lexicon. Over my years, I have heard many of my colleagues say, "That dog won't hunt," to refer to an idea or a process that is doomed. Every time I hear this saying, I know that John left a little bit of Texas in the Boston University vocabulary. John didn't move his family here from Texas just to teach New Englanders how to speak Texas English. He saw the potential in a regional commuter school and came here to raise our standards, our sights, and our stature. He gathered around him like-minded leaders, and to whom he also taught these great Texas phrases, and led the transformation of Boston University into the residential private research university that is the foundation of the institution that we support and nurture today. Although trained as a philosopher, like his father, John was an architect at heart. For Boston University, he envisioned a campus more integrated, coherent, and green than he found in 1971 when he arrived. We appreciate the linden trees and other species that he had planted, and which will flourish beyond his and our lifetimes. More importantly, the complex property acquisitions made on John's watch have made possible for us to envision a still more integrated and attractive campus today and in our future. In fact, all we need to do is to look at the West Campus complex of recreational facilities and the high-rise residences to see the importance of John's long-term vision for Boston University as a residential university. I believe that John's most enduring legacy to Boston University will be his commitment to the quality of our faculty, academic programs, and students. Distinguished faculty recruited early in John's tenure became the vanguard in our emergence as a modern research community. His untiring attention to faculty hiring and promotion and his stubborn and uncompromising demand for quality laid the foundation for the institution that Boston University is today. The people he brought to Boston University and the standards he set for all of us are his greatest legacies to this institution. Our distinguished speakers, all of whom have known John for many years, will speak today about his life and his service to Boston University, the city, and our nation, as well as his place in the community of scholars and public servants. We are grateful for their presence today and their taking time to record thoughtful comments if they could not be here with us. There is a particular quality about John that we should especially cherish and emulate. It is captured in a quotation from Immanuel Kant, who, it seems, should have been an honorary Texan, and who was the primary focus of John's scholarly life in philosophy. Kant said, "The individual who sets no goals suffers his fate. The individual who sets goals fashions his own. With big goals, big heart, hard work, and some punchy Texas aphorisms, John helped Boston University make its own luck, starting with very limited means and facing some significant obstacles. With his grit implanted in Boston University's DNA, we will continue to set big goals, work hard, and hopefully make our own luck. And we will never forget John's great contributions. It's my pleasure to ask Bob Knox, Chairman of the Board of Trustees, to come to the podium.
John Silber came to BU in the winter of 1971. That was the second semester of my freshman year. It was a turbulent time during the Vietnam War, less than a year after Kent State, and BU, the BU campus was a hotbed of angry students who hated the war and despised authority of any kind. Dr. Silber had decided to take a tour of the campus dorms, and when he came to Miles Standish Hall, then an all-male dorm, I found myself milling about in a small meeting room packed with long-haired students awaiting the arrival of our new president. The Daily Free Press had been reporting on Dr. Silber's negative views of student lifestyles, and there was a hostile, carnival-like atmosphere in the room, accompanied, if I remember right, by the faint aroma of marijuana. President Silber stood in front of the crowd and began a direct critique of the decadent state of student life in his soon-to-be-famous take-no-prisoners style. He was met by an increasing level of jeers, catcalls, and wise guy comments. And one student shouted a crude remark about John's right arm. John promptly abandoned his speech and delivered an extemporaneous indictment of the student's shameful ignorance in a dissertation on the value of civil discourse and respect for others that was both powerful and eloquent. Instantly, the atmosphere in that room morphed from raucous and disrespectful to stunned silence as we collectively realized that our new president, although small in physical stature, was a huge and powerful intellect. He was a fearless man with a commanding presence, the likes of which we had never seen in our short lives. That first encounter with John at Miles Standish was permanently embedded in my 18-year-old brain. It's still as vivid today as it was then. Fast forward some 30 years. Somehow, instead of becoming a war protester or a professor, I surprisingly had become a successful venture capitalist. Now, full disclosure, many of you here know that I used to call myself a private equity guy, but that was before Mitt Romney came along and ruined that. And I was invited to join the board of BU trustees. My first assignment as a trustee was to serve on the investment committee. And before I knew it, I was sitting across the table from John Silber in his conference room at 147 Bay State Road. The committee was discussing a private equity investment for which President Silber was a strong advocate. And in short order, the investment was presented for a vote. Except for me, it appeared that the vote was going to be unanimous, but I saw serious problems with the investment, and I began to state my objection. And as I spoke, I could see that everyone was focused not on me, but on John Silber, anticipating the sharp rebuttal that was sure to follow, maybe with some personal criticism of me or my standing as a mere rookie trustee. I had flashbacks to the incident at Miles Standish and prepared to be verbally castigated by John. When I finished stating my case, John clearly was not happy with me, but to my surprise and those of others in the room, he acknowledged the merits of my objections and proposed that the vote be postponed until there could be further investigation. As the meeting was breaking up, and perhaps as evidence that he didn't begrudge my opposition to the deal, John told me one of the funniest jokes I have ever heard. Unfortunately, it's not repeatable here today. See me at the reception. I found out from this and other encounters that John respected people who disagreed with him and were prepared to assert and defend their positions. But he had little patience for those who were unprepared to defend their views, and even less for people who agreed with him simply because they lacked the intellectual courage to offer a differing view. John was a man, as we all know, who relished verbal combat. If there was a lull in the battle, he sought to arrange for the resumption of hostilities as quickly as possible. He was unafraid to express the truth as he saw it, regardless of the popularity of his position or the receptivity of his audience. Sometimes this had major consequences, especially with the media here in Boston. Shortly after he arrived at the university, John was invited to an editorial board meeting at the Boston Globe. But nobody told him that the Globe editorial board in those days was essentially a branch of the Harvard Alumni Association. John described his vision for BU, how he wanted to transform it into a great research university that would attract outstanding faculty and students. Bill Taylor, the publisher of the Globe, said that the Boston area already had great research universities in Harvard and MIT, and that schools such as BU, BC, and Northeastern had long and adequately served the first generation college student. Taylor said it sounded like John wanted to turn BU into another Harvard. "No," said John, "I don't want to turn BU into another Harvard. I want to turn it into a really good school." John then went on to acknowledge that Harvard had many great scholars, but few of them ever saw undergraduates in the classroom. He wanted to recruit great scholars, and he would require them to teach undergrads, a practice which has served BU well for four decades. But those thoughts were too late and didn't matter. John had challenged the status quo, and I'm not sure the brain trust on Morrissey Boulevard ever forgave him. John had a wonderful sense of humor and would even volunteer to be the target of a really good joke. In November of 88, the Boston Globe ran an absolutely terrible photo of John taken at Chelsea City Hall in which he looked like a very angry Grinch. And John hated the photo. A member of his staff obtained a print and had it turned into a 1989 calendar, which he presented to John a few weeks before Christmas. Initially, John expressed extreme displeasure with some classic Silber colorful language. But then he asked two questions. How much did it cost to make, and how much could we get for it if we sold copies at the BU bookstore? John's trusted lieutenant, Joe Mercurio, who was responsible for overseeing the bookstore and the entire BU empire, asked John three times if he really wanted to sell that calendar in the public. But John was insistent, as he so often was, so the calendar went on sale for $5.95, a single page with a horrible photo of John and all 12 months displayed underneath it, and amazingly, it sold out in 2 days. Many people who bought the calendar asked John to autograph it, and he said, "Sure, give me $5. Back then, Roger Clemens, the great Red Sox pitcher from Texas, was charging $10 for his autograph. So if someone asked John why he was charging $5 for his autograph, he'd wave his right arm and say, "If that two-armed Texan, Roger Clemens, can get $10, I sure as hell ought to be able to get $5. All proceeds from the sale of the autographs and John's signature went to the Chelsea Public Schools. John was never afraid to speak the truth, whether in a campus dorm, a conference room at the Globe, or on the campaign trail when he ran for governor. I'd like to read some words I received in an email from Denise Torrey, who was a friend of mine when I was a student, a 1972 graduate of Comm, and worked with John in his 1990 campaign for governor. During his campaign for governor, John publicly called Bill Weld the orange-headed wasp. I just wanted to crawl into a hole. I was so embarrassed for him. But he didn't think it was a big deal, because what he said was true, even if it wasn't very genteel to describe his opponent. And she continues, and that's the thing I remember most about John. his uncanny, unwavering ability to not only see the truth, but to state it fearlessly and unapologetically. This is what bothered people sometimes, their inability or unwillingness to see the truths he pointed out. He said it so simply and directly that people were often caught off guard. Denise concludes, in the insanity and uncertainty of the 1970s, John Silber had the rare ability to reduce the complexities of the time to their basic elements. This is the essence of intellectual analysis, and no one was better at it than John. He was a simplifier, not a complicator. I learned something important from John Silber every day. What better thing can one say about a great teacher? As a student, a parent of two BU graduates, and as a trustee, I have been extremely fortunate to have witnessed the full arc of the magic John Silber has worked at this university. No one loved BU more than John, or was more dedicated to its success. Through the power of his intellect and the strength of his convictions, John truly shaped and personified Boston University. As we celebrate the life of this extraordinary teacher, philosopher, builder, politician, and artist, we should remember that we are now the guardians of the invaluable gift of his legacy, which is the present-day Boston University. It is our privilege and indeed our duty to honor John by diligently continuing his work of building an ever greater Boston University. This task is made easier because of what he accomplished and the momentum of his grand project he began more than four decades ago. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, I want to express our deep appreciation for John Silber's remarkable life and all of his magnificent accomplishments. We should also remember that John was a husband, a father of eight, a grandfather to 26, and we offer our deepest condolences to the entire Silber family. We have lost a leader, a friend, and a family member. But John Silber endures in the brick and mortar of this university, in the vast intellectual capital he amassed on our behalf, and in the hearts and minds of those who knew him and loved him. As many of you know, Dr. Silber was appointed by President Reagan to the National Bipartisan Commission on Central America in 1983. The chairman of that commission, Henry Kissinger, could not be here today. Henry Kissinger and John were great friends, and Dr. Kissinger shares his thoughts about John in the following video. Please roll Dr. Kissinger.
John Silber was a man of integrity, character, and courage. He also was my friend. Our relationship began in an extraordinarily inauspicious manner. John Silber was assigned to a group appointed by President Reagan, of which I was chairman, which was supposed to deal with the future of Central America. John Silber was extremely suspicious of governmental enterprises of that kind because he considered them a likely route to compromise, a concept of which he was profoundly suspicious. So when the meeting started, he made sure that everybody understood what he stood for and was unbelievably difficult. Indeed, it reached the point where I thought that one more discussion like this and we would have to part company. But then I had a private meeting with him, and I said, look, we both want to achieve a good result, and nobody's going to ask you to compromise. You help us get a unanimous report on the cultural, economic, and social issues, and I will back you up. After that, we became friends. And John worked with dedication, inspiration, to produce an outstanding report that had the unanimous support of the heavily laden political figures on both sides of that group. John and I remained friends for all the decades since. He was a man that on whom one could always count. I never wrote an article or appeared on television where I did not hear from John with a word of encouragement or a word of criticism. And because one could always rely on it, both of them were extremely important. We kept in loose contact over the years. I visited him several times in Boston. He came to see me occasionally in New York. But John Silber was one of those men that you did not need to see all the time to know where he stood. He was a patriot. He was a believer in freedom. He did not preach his objectives, but he lived them. He was totally reliable. I will miss him deeply, and for me, and for America, the world will be a lonelier place without him. But those whose lives he touched will maintain his memory and will be helped by his inspiration.
Of the many impressive and to many of us endearing qualities of John Silber, intelligence, candor, combativeness, eloquence, the one that always will remain paramount to me was the courage of his intellectual constancy. This has been mentioned, but almost everyone we know at some stage in their life bends with prevailing winds, but not John Silber. Over the more than 40 years I was privileged to know him, beginning as a student at the University of Texas, on through serving on the board of Boston University during the days of his, or years of his remarkable presidency. I never saw any wind or gale or Hurricane Sandy that moved the foundations of the character and consistency of Dr. Silber. He was thus sometimes quick to call others who did bend with prevailing winds. When his fellow university president, Larry Summers, seemed to be apologizing after provoking the departure of Professor Cornell West from Harvard to Princeton University, Dr. Silber said to me, well, if he had any courage or at least common sense, he would have simply said, Mr. West's departure to Princeton raised the IQ of both institutions. John was almost always correct, but never politically correct. When I first met him, he was a youthful dean of arts and sciences at UT, and I was a beginning reporter covering him for the student newspaper. And the anti-war protests were in full campus flower, even in Texas. And those few on the faculty who disagreed with the protesters were not eager to publicly say so. But John Silber was the one man on campus who repeatedly dared to face the protesters, not so much because he was for the war, but because he was against the lack of civility and the know-nothingness that pervaded so much of the anti-war movement. I can still see him standing a lone figure in front of the big tower that houses the administration at the University of Texas, confronting angry protesters while the rest of the administration cowered in their offices in the tower. He was also dared to confront the chairman of the Board of Regents of the University of Texas, a man named Frank Irwin, who Dr. Silber saw as more interested in expanding the university than in improving the educational quality of the university. So he said to him, don't you have a conflict of interest? Because Mr. Irwin and some of his business partners were building dorms and condos adjacent to the university. And Frank Irwin, who I also covered, said, Silber, you'll never learn. Where there's no conflict, there's no interest. I see Vartan Gregorian shaking his head. He was at the university in those days. But Dr. Silber never shied away from conflict, and he was never seduced by self-interest. Several years later, Mr. Irwin suddenly decided that the College of Arts and Sciences at UT was too large and needed to be broken up into parts. What he was really deciding was that the dean of the college was too big and needed to be split from the university. So he summoned Dr. Silber and offered him the chance to resign. Predictably, Dr. Silber declined. And Irwin said, well, I guess I'm just going to have to make you famous, John, by firing you. And he did. Standing up to this physically, I was not there, so this is a story I have heard from John, but standing up to Mr. Irwin, who was a physically very large man, he said, so what advice do you have for me? This is a pretty high tuition you're charging me, so what's the education I'm supposed to receive? And Irwin thought for a moment and then said, don't ever take a number two position. And John never did. So the University of Texas loss quickly became Boston University's gain. And for the rest of Dr. Silber's long career, he never again played second fiddle. And to some of us, he was the entire orchestra. The move to Massachusetts was not without ironies. During his years in largely conservative Texas, he was always seen as a liberal because he supported integration, he supported early childhood education, he opposed capital punishment in a state that still, 50 years later, proudly puts to death criminals. But when he moved to Massachusetts, where the last execution had occurred in 1947, he channeled those energies and interests into supporting a professor on the BU campus who wanted to teach inmates. And some of those inmates actually received degrees. And at a ceremony to thank Dr. Silber for his role in this, the inmates summed up their gratitude with a plaque that said, we came here in chains, and through education, you have made us free men. Still, here he was viewed as a conservative because he supported ROTC on campus. He opposed some welfare programs that he felt were destructive to the integrity of family, and he spoke out against things like casual sex. The point, obviously, is that Dr. Silber's views did not change, simply the audiences for them changed. He remained throughout his life true to what he described himself frequently as a Truman Democrat, who, like Hubert Humphrey, believed that the measure of a society is how it treats those at the dawn of life, those in the twilight of life, and those in the shadows of life. So popularity was not something that Silber sought, and it was often something that he was denied. But he stuck to his values anyway, and the institution that he built and nurtured and led for more than a quarter of a century did achieve a level of popularity with all of its constituencies. And thanks to John Silber, has become one of the great centers of intellectual inquiry, research, learning in this country. What a legacy. What a man. Excuse me. In addition to his causes and passions, one of his great loves was music, and especially opera. And he recruited the great diva Phyllis Curtin as the Dean of Fine Arts at BU. And under her leadership, the university founded the Opera Institute. So today we will have the privilege of hearing the 2012 Phyllis Curtin Scholar, Celeste Frazier, who will do a musical tribute to Dr. Silber.
Peep down and see way beyond where we can. We can see. I first met John Silber as I was a journalist doing a magazine piece, and I covered a talk by John at a New England civil servants conference set in a lovely venue somewhere in eastern Connecticut. And I always remember John's speech because to these civil servants, his subject was the inherent restraints on creativity in the civil service. As you've heard before, John couldn't bring himself to flatter aimlessly. He couldn't. That was probably the most depressing speech the civil servants had had ever heard. But John also had, in my experience anyway, a wonderful, caring attitude towards everyone, and me especially. I gave the year 2000 commencement address at Boston University. And as I was getting ready, going to the podium, I was instructed gently to look out at the audience, and said, "We want to put a special robe around your neck. So we're going to take off your academic robes." So I put my hands back like this, and somebody slipped the robes on me. And I looked down, and I was entirely in white. White academic robes with the red, with a generous use of red felt and other piping. From that moment on, I had no idea what I was going to say. I discovered that this was something that John had dreamed up, knowing my fondness for things white. And he had this robe made, gone right to the manufacturers who usually make these things, had phoned to people in New York to find out my size. So the robe was absolutely perfect. Well, I was swept away by the robe. Anything that I could say seemed to me rather minor importance after that. I loved it so much that I just couldn't take it off. And I got on the shuttle to come back to New York wearing the robe. And as I passed down the aisle, I heard a little girl say to her mother, "Mommy, is that the Pope?" Even then, I wasn't embarrassed enough to take that robe off. So I reached New York, and I went to the baggage handling area. And everyone was staring at me, I noticed. And finally, a man who'd had enough of this came up to me, and he said, "Now, who are you supposed to be?" And I said, "The Pope." But when I think of all the effort, all of the thoughtfulness that went into my robe, which I now, people think around, well, not that I give that many commencement speeches, but they all think I'm from Boston University, because I always wear that, that robe. Now, there's a side that has been, of John has been touched on today several times. A gaffe is literally saying something out of place, substantially impolite. In politics, it has come to mean something else. It has come to mean saying what you actually mean. And I have a soft spot in my heart for Joe Biden. When there was a severe outbreak of a communicable disease, I forget what it was, in Mexico City, he was asked by a reporter if he would allow his daughter to go to Mexico City. Now, he said, hell no. And well, that was considered terribly impolite to the country of Mexico. And you would have thought that there was going to be a diplomatic crisis as a result of that remark, but that's exactly the way he felt. Well, of course, that was John all the way through. He could not bring himself to bend his thoughts for publicity, let's say. In the famous, in his famous run for governor, in the last days of the campaign, and he was ahead, and he was ahead in the polls. He did an interview with Natalie Jacobson, a very pretty, very influential anchor in the Boston area, and this was the sort of thing that's done inside the home of the candidate. The same thing was done with William Weld, and she asked John what he thought of certain criticisms of himself, and suddenly turned to his grandchild and said, "Do you think that's true? And John said, "That's off limits. You know, you don't go asking my grandchild for public opinion." She asked John one of those questions that I think of as sort of a Rorschach fishing. She said, "What do you fear most?" John said, "You're supposed to be the reporter. Why don't you find out?" was said to have quite a negative impact on the campaign. I can only wonder what would have happened if John had won that election. This country would not be the same. You can be sure of that. It would have been a wonderful, wonderful moment. I really mean this, in American history. Because as recently, you have an election between two people who appear to be made of silly putty. Whatever the thrust of public opinion goes, they bend with it. That would not have been the case with John. Twice after that, in the year 2000, also 2004, I wrote in John Silber's name. I figured if I didn't vote for him, he wasn't going to have a chance. I mean, people have to get together on these things. And a reporter happened to see me walking out of a polling place and said, "Well, who did you vote for?" And I said, "John Silber." And this was taken to be some sort of nonsense remark, but it was the most sensible remark that I could have made. The great Stoic Epictetus, who lived at the time of Nero, said, "As long as you do not deny what is true, and as long as you do not assent to what is false, you are a free man." And when the Emperor Nero issued an edict compelling the philosophers to cut off their beards, that was the symbol of a philosopher. When the Roman soldiers arrived at Epictetus's home, he refused to have his beard cut. And they said, well, we're going to have to kill you. And he said, you do what you have to do, I'll do what I have to do. They were so impressed that instead of killing him, they sent him into exile, which was a pretty bad thing in those days. But I somehow think of John Silber in that way. He did not assent to what was false. He did not deny what was true. He was a great man.
Good afternoon. Dean Hill and I did not compare notes prior to this memorial service. Nevertheless, both of us have turned to Psalm 137 when preparing our remarks. As Bob noted, much of this psalm emphasizes God's ubiquitous presence throughout and beyond our lives on earth. O Lord, you have examined me and know me. When I sit down or stand up, you know it. You discern my thoughts from afar. There is not a word on my tongue, but that you, O Lord, know it well. If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I descend to Sheol, you are there also. It was you who created my inward parts. You fashioned me in my mother's womb. How weighty your thoughts seem to me, O God. How great their number. I count them. They exceed the grains of sand. I end, but am with you still. If you believe in heaven, you can bet your buttons it's more intriguing a place than ever since straight-shooting John Silber came to town. When I imagine heaven, I don't think of harps, hymns, and halos. I anticipate open-ended dialogues between extraordinary persons whose earthly lives did not coincide. Since Dr. Silber's death, I have pondered who his most fascinating biblical conversation partners might be. And I've concluded that John's scriptural soul brother is the priest and prophet Ezekiel. To be sure, these two men, separated by cultures, continents, and 26 centuries, had their differences. Ezekiel was deported to Mesopotamia in 597 BCE, part of a brain drain by which the Neo-Babylonian Empire sought to subdue the troublesome vassal state of Judah. John, a Texan, moved to Neo England when BU's Board of Trustees sought to infuse a struggling commuter rail university with fresh intellectual verve. Ezekiel insisted that he could speak only divine words. John never claimed to be God's spokesman, but he spoke and wrote with an unmistakable air of authority. As a priest, Ezekiel was thoroughly steeped in the rituals and regulations of Jerusalem's temple. John spent only a year at Yale Divinity School. Ezekiel quarried aspects of his honor, shame, culture in order to create contrition in his exilic audience. John rejected the religious guilt of his Calvinist upbringing. Ezekiel ingested a scroll replete with divinely authored words of lamentation, mourning, and woe, and found it sweet as honey. I do not know if Dr. Silber had a sweet tooth, but sugar-coating words was not his style. Despite their differences, however, Ezekiel and John had much in common. Both men were among the intellectual cognoscenti of their times. The book bearing Ezekiel's name testifies to his encyclopedic knowledge of wide-ranging subjects, from smelting to sacrifice, to his creative transformations of traditions, his mastery of metaphor and minutiae. John Silber possessed double measures of these same qualities. He spoke knowledgeably on a broad spectrum of subjects, believed one could transform society's most staid structures and institutions, and eagle-eyed every detail, especially those you most hoped he would overlook. Even his detractors acknowledged the breadth and depth of his brilliance, the power of his mind at work. Both men relished vigorous, reasoned arguments. The book of Ezekiel bristles with disputation speeches, oracles in which a prophet cites a widespread opinion, often in the form of a proverb, counters it, and then seeks systematically to dismantle it. No, you cannot blame forebears for your failings. No, you cannot sidestep harsh critiques even when they upend your most cherished beliefs. John knew how to deploy an apt adage, to wield traditional wisdom at precisely the right moment. And he was more than willing to debate the social, political, and intellectual status quo, subjecting especially the hallowed halls of academia to a rigid scrutiny. Both Ezekiel and John were visionaries. In his fourth and final vision report, Ezekiel described down to the last cubit a perfectly restored Israelite society living in a perfectly ordered homeland under the leadership of a perfectly ordered priesthood serving in a perfectly ordered temple complex. John envisioned, down to every inch of its perfectly manicured urban campus, a new world-class BU, everywhere shaped by the highest standards of excellence, academic and otherwise. But both men knew that in order to build up, you also have to tear down. Ezekiel ruthlessly rejected much of the religious orthodoxy of his day, insisting that neither divine presence nor human wickedness could be taken lightly. John attacked mediocrity in all its guises, insisting that universities bore special responsibility for instilling visions of excellence in generations of their students. And of course, both men had a knack for alienating audiences. Ezekiel's fellow exiles acknowledged his authority as priest and prophet, but they were more than willing to argue against his ideas, reject his hermeneutics of history, and worst of all, ignore his attempts to convict them of his point of view. John's MO endeared him to some, offended others, and one occasionally suspected that for him, the phrase worthy opponent was oxymoronic. But neither man could be accused of apathy. They shunned sentimentality. The word love appears just once in the book of Ezekiel's 48 chapters. But both were passionate about their life's work. I might not make it to heaven, but theirs is a conversation I'd hate to miss.
John Silber, educator, teacher, philosopher, and friend. When have I met him? I met him in the early 70s when he called one day and simply offering me an honorary degree. On the telephone, I checked my calendar and I came back and said, I'm terribly sorry, Dr. Silber. That day, I'm embarrassed to tell you, I am accepting an honorary degree elsewhere. So he said, okay, how about next year? And I thought, what a man. He's already planning ahead a whole year. And not only does he know what he will do that year, he also wants to know what I will do on that day next year. We came next year, I took my wife with me. And okay, it was a good ceremony. And it was good because it's rare, but usually when you accept a degree, you have to make a speech. But I didn't even have to make a speech, just came to accept the degree. It was nice. And as we sat down for lunch, he began talking to my wife. And all of a sudden he said, what about coming to BU? And I said, no, really, what for? Tell me. I'm now what we call a distinguished professor in Jewish studies at City College. And I'm very happy. I'm a university professor there, they called it a distinguished professor, and very well paid, not much teaching, and we are in New York, why should I come? So he began convincing my wife, and she fell for it. So we accepted actually to come to Boston. And I must say, just as there is a love at first sight, it was a friendship at first sight. We became immediately friends. And that friendship lasted really until his last day. Oh, I have so many stories about that, what we have done together. I remember he wanted me to be present at one point when he had a very tough discussion with some professors. And the way he behaved on stage when he was criticized, he wasn't angry, he didn't protest, he just remained who he was. Without defending himself, just being who he was. Another story, also funny. It was the third or fourth year of my teaching here at Boston University. All of a sudden, I gave a lecture at an important university in New York when the president came to us and said, how about accepting a chair at that university? And I said, gentlemen, I am at Boston University. So he also went to my wife. And he offered really something very, very great. First of all, lodging, great apartment. Double the salary almost, and less teaching. And above all, an argument, I will not have to commute. Otherwise, I would come every week, I would have to commute. Indeed, commuting. So I said, oh, why not actually? The problem was John Silber. What could I say to John Silber? I asked, see him, I came to see him, and I began saying, look, Mr. President, it's very nice, your behavior is very beautiful. There's only, you know, the problem is that for you, not only for me. For me, it's a technical problem to come, to take a plane and come once a week. But it's not, I think it's not nice for the public image of Boston University, that the Mellon Professor of the Humanities and the Professor of Philosophy, all the titles I have, should be on a computer, on a level of coming once a week like that. It's not nice for the university. It's a problem for you as well as for me. And therefore, I thought he would say, really, it is. And then I would have said, Mr. President, in that case, look, I like Boston University, and therefore I will stay with it. I'll give you a lecture a year free without really, just without salary. But let's quit it. But he cut me off. He said, I have no problem with what you are doing. There is no problem. The main thing is you are with us. In the meantime, the other president had already prepared a contract. He had already signed it. All was needed was my signature. And I thought I would call my wife and say, okay, you can sign it for me. But I called, I said, I cannot. I don't know. I couldn't do it to John. That's how I remained here. And I remained as a very grateful professor, grateful not only to John, but to the university as such, to my colleagues, to those who worked for him, and for me, therefore, for all of us. Then we would travel. Whatever I did, really, I did with him. I organized, since I got the Nobel Prize, I organized Nobel conferences all over the world. And I invited also John Silber, although he was not a Nobel, maybe because there is Nobel for education. But otherwise, he would have deserved it, probably. And we went to Moscow, went to Paris, and to Prague, all over the world with him. And whenever he spoke, people listened attentively, because he was not really provocative, but he was enlightening. He always had at least a way of finding something new to say about something old. Because he was a philosopher after all, a Kantian philosopher. And I think what he was proud of is not only of his achievement in the field of education, but also of his knowledge of Kant. His books on Kant are very important volumes for students who study Kant or who study philosophy in those times. I took him to Jerusalem with us, and he brought two of his daughters with him. And he went to Yad Vashem, which is the remembrance hall in Jerusalem. It changed his life. For him, the tragedy of the Jewish people, which means actually the tragedy for the whole world, it affected him more than he admitted publicly. He did not teach the same way anymore. He did not behave the same way anymore. He realized that that event had to change not human nature, that you cannot do, but human behavior. And whenever we dealt in our conversations, or whenever he dealt in his, about that event with the capital E, it was something so profound in him that came out. He told me about some members of his family who also were killed or imprisoned, or both, in that area, in that event. His late years, he even thought more about it. Maybe when he felt that death was coming closer, he thought of those who died then with much more clarity. I remember he was always taken by my commitment to human rights. We spoke about it a lot. And one day I came to him, it was in the early 90s, when Russians were going through a new quasi-revolution, and they arrested Gorbachev. I had a friend who was the editor-in-chief of Crocodile, a humoristic magazine in Russia, and he was here by chance, and he was afraid to go back because he had offended so many of those leaders. And also he knew that if he was going back, he would be arrested. At the same time, he had to go back. He had no reason to stay. What could he say to them? So I asked John what to do. He said, it's very simple. We'll give him a position here. It will be a great excuse for him to stay. He gave him a position. He stayed here, I think, a year or so. Then he could go back. And that saved his life. That's really John Silber. He used his power to help other people. The truth is that I don't know whether he had a method in education. I am not sure that he had a philosophy of education. I mean, a philosophy that you say A, B, C, D. All he had was a sense of not only justice, but of promise that the student is entitled to get the best teachers that he or she can have. And therefore, the teacher is entitled to have the best students that professor he or she would aspire to get. And to bring them together was actually John Silber's dream. So was he a professor of education? He was a professor and an educator, and maybe at times in hours of grace when he wrote those books, that he thought about it. But one thing I remember we discussed a lot about moral philosophy, which I try to teach, not simple philosophy, but moral philosophy, which appealed to him that much. And therefore education as well, because we both agreed that unfortunately, to our embarrassment, in those times of darkness and murder, many of the killers had college degrees, and some of them even had PhDs, which means something was wrong with what they learned in class. If Kant and Rembrandt couldn't stop them from becoming inhuman in their life, something was wrong with what they learned in the classroom about painting, art, or philosophy. The last years were tough for him. I used to come and see him each time I came to Boston. But nevertheless, he had always a sense of humor, a biting sense of humor, and a curiosity. He also wanted to know not only the thing in itself about you were talking, but more than that, each time more. And that is, of course, the educator in him. Teaching means to ask the student to go deeper, to know more and better. He was never satisfied with what he had done. And although it comes to Boston University, what he has done for our university is surely a source of satisfaction to all of us. And now I've spoken to him, I think, 3 days or four before he died. I got his letter after he died, simply saying, now I'm going to die. And then something very personal. I don't know what he's doing there up in heaven, in which he believed, I think. I think that he is trying to give advice to God how to rule his universe. I'm sure that he's looking down, and at one point his eye must stop here in Boston, at this unique place of learning which Boston University is. And I'm sure he looks at it with melancholy and pride and with an openness for his successor, wishing him to do whatever he can and will do for our school. And I'm sure that when he does so with a smile.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. President, fellow speakers, faculty members, trustees, and of course, wonderful Silber family. I was asked to speak about Silber the educator, but after all these personal stories, and after 44 years of friendship with John, despite the fact also right before he died, he called me, said, I'm going to die, and do you call this living? It's not worth living. But in the middle of that, he admonished me, which is best tribute you can pay for a friend. He said, I know you may be asked to speak at my memorial. Don't filibuster it, he said. And I did not know whether to cry or laugh. But anyway, I have lots of stories. I was asked to speak about Silber the Educator. I'll do that by going fast, but I'd like to say several stories, which Mr. Knox's stories reinforced it. Silber hired me to University of Texas. That much I knew. But I did not know why. I did not realize that he was member of jury of Danforth Foundation, E.H. Harbison Distinguished Teaching Award winners. And I was one of them in 1968. I did not know that other professors were members of jury, Arrowsmith, Roger Shattuck, and others. It was his plan to bring practically all Danforth Distinguished Teaching professors to Texas. And frankly, I'm going to confess, I wrote in my book, but I have to confess, I did not know difference between Houston and Austin. I thought people said Austin, some say Houston. I never had looked back. I was a parochial Californian. Well, I arrived, 1968, and a friendship was formed. First thing I would tell you, he asked me, how are you going to be understood by Texas students? First morning when I went to my classroom, Intellectual History of Europe, 150, 200 students, I said, ladies and gentlemen, I have been told you have a problem with your accent. I'm going to do my level best to understand you. Class laughed, they left me alone. As a result, I got my Texas accents. Second one, when I went to his office, he said, what do you think of this, his right arm? I said, it's a weapon. You're damn right, he said. Okay. Then one day he asked me, how do you fight? Because both of us had bullies at school. Mine was, I said, first day of school opening, I went and picked on the biggest bully at the school. I went and hit him. And afterwards, I got beat up. But nobody tangled with me. That's what I like, he said. All right? I provoked so that to be left alone for the rest of the year. So then he said, how do you fight? Very personal, I said. Show me, he said. So I stood right before him, and I banged his head. So he has blamed all about his anger, lack of anger management, and everything he's done at BU to me, because I hit his head so hard it had took 20 years to recover from that. And then, last but least, also, I tell you that I performed surgery on John Silver's toe. He had a splinter there. I said, let me help you. I almost killed him, he told me. I had this needle poking in his toe trying to get this splinter expelled. My wife said, it's none of your business to do this. And John told me also I tried to poison him. But then, there was one thing I want to tell you. I was for 22 years, member of Boston University Board of Trustees. Why? David Risman, dear friend of mine and Silver's, said, Vartan, he needs you to calm him down. So please, I'm going to recommend you for Boston University. Sit among trustees right across from him. Every time his temper rises, you smile. And he tuned down, which happened to be true, once, not always. So I was John's supervisor, in a sense. And then he told me one day, Listen, you say things, people give you standing ovation. I say the same thing, they call me fascist. So what's the point? I say, John, if our objective is to break a window, I put my stone in Godiva chocolate coating, I throw it, breaks the window. They say, Godiva chocolate broke our window. In your case, I said, this crude stone was hurled by this man, John Silber. So he laughed. But then on the serious side, I tell you, in 44 years, we're different, as you know, from everything, politically and others. So we have never lost a day of friendship. Every time there was a tragedy, he was there, and I was there. You did not even have to ask him. We enjoyed our family's joys and our family's tragedies. And if you had John Silber as a friend, you did not need any other friend. It's true that many of his friends took advantage of him, terribly disappointed him. Not many, some. He never blamed them for his failures. He assumed full responsibility. So that was John. So let me first describe John's career to you, having said these things, which I've never said publicly before. In 1968, when I went to Texas, I joined the faculty. Silber was the star. He wanted to transform University of Texas. In 10 years, he said, we're going to have one of the best 20 universities in the world. But Texas had the money. It had Chancellor Ransom, brilliant man who had persuaded state legislature that libraries, manuscripts are also to be considered capital projects. Because Texas has lots of fund for building, did not have fund for faculty salaries and others. So Ransom built one of the best humanities libraries in the world by purchasing everything, including renting the baskets of the waste paper baskets of all the writers in England and others. It has also one of the best fake collections in the world. So if somebody bought it, they say, if it's fake, why don't we say the best fake collection in the world? Now, when I arrived, all Texans were thinking about whether John Silber one day will be president of University of Texas system or chancellor. So every move John did, he was a suspect. And so when he said to me, they're asking for increasing the size of student body 40,000 instead of 30,000. And he had just spoken about that students are being depersonalized, they need teachers to teach, teachers to know them, so they can write recommendations and have a dialectical discussion. This was not possible with 40,000 students. And I said, why are they doing this? And Karen already mentioned the housing project. So real estate industry, building industry, and all the professions were united to add 10,000 new students in Texas. So Silber opposed it. I said, what did they offer you before? He said, they offered me to buy a chunk of property, what they're going to build. I said, what did you do? I turned them down. I said, you're going to be fired. So he said, no, it's not that way. It was that way. So he opposed. Chairman already was mentioned, Frank Irwin, after trying various ways of forcing him to quit, and nobody dared to fire him, by the way. It was Irwin took him to 40 Acres Club and Don Weissman's office. The time is up. Your time is up. You have to leave. And this is the discussion I just want to mention. What has Silber done? Silber had frozen one-third of faculty salaries because they were mediocre. This was opening the year, entering new Dean of College of Arts and Sciences. He had fired 22 of 28 department chairmen because they had not built their department. Years later, when my wife and I having dinner with President Meyerson of University of Pennsylvania, he recalled Buffalo when he had fired 29. And John said, I can whip, because he should have been able to do that many. But his aim was to renew, bring new faculty all over the world, and make Texas great. So since Silber was told by Frank Irwin, if you don't, I'm going to fire you, making you famous, Karen Meshdos. They offered him a good deal in that professorship, travel money, European ideas. Silber said no. Because Silber and Socratic dialogue kind of thing, once you make a stand, you want to defend the stand. He would never ask for amnesty. And that was one of the things that he hated, when students occupied the place right after the amnesty. No, he said, if you're occupied, you have to go through, because you compare yourself to Gandhi, and you compare yourself to Martin Luther King. And what is this? You come occupied, that we give you amnesty. What have you done? Then did Karl Marx ask for amnesty? Did Martin Luther ask for amnesty? Did Gandhi ask for amnesty? Using what Mr. Knox mentioned, the same arguments. So that's out of question. So in many ways, therefore, he said, I would like to be fired. And he was fired, and University of Texas went through great turmoil. Unfortunately, I was one of three, four faculty ringleaders at the time, and it was not pleasant, I can tell you that, because I pretended to be foreigner, which I was. I had read Federalist Papers. So I asked once Mr. Irwin, where is it written that 600 people vote this way and 50 the other way and 50 win? In which chapter of Federalist Papers? They could not say it's a raw political power. And Texas had raw political power. Well, then came Silber. Faculty came to believe. They came to visit from Boston University, because his name was put in Boston University president. I want to clarify one thing, because it's always said, somebody in interview, that I misled committee that came to interview Silber. I told them good things about Silber. On the contrary, I sent them to all the critics of John Silber, 14, 15 of them. After committee members met with 14, 15 of them, they changed their opinion to be higher, more higher opinion of Silber than it had come. Because, you mentioned, Karen, they thought if Silber is a radical in Texas for against death penalty, for integration of blacks, and so forth, so on, so on, imagine what he'll be in Boston. He's a revolutionary. They had miscalculated it. So Silber came to Boston University, determined several things. He came with many companions, and Mr. President, you mentioned, he also came with Immanuel Kant. Entire John's political and educational philosophy derives from Kant, as interpreted by Silber. I should say that. So he wanted BU to be a big player in Boston. He wanted it to play not to play auxiliary enterprise or back office to two leading universities in Boston that you mentioned, Cambridge. When they say Cambridge, I say England is doing very well. No, we're not talking about the other place, but never mind. He wanted BU to be known for excellence in teaching, but also research. His ambition was that one day BU will be a member of AAU. And it's being done now, thanks to you, Mr. President, and faculty, and also trustees and others. But John Silber's dream was this, that BU will be taken seriously, not as an athletic power alone, but as serious intellectual power in Boston. He also admonished many people in my presence, Jewish, Armenian, Greek, and all kinds of emigres, Catholic, who were discriminated by sister institutions in Boston. Boston gave them room to come and to graduate and take their American dream. He told them, shame on you. You were denied when you were nobody. Now that you're somebody, you give money to other institutions for prestige purposes. And also was present on occasions, it was mentioned, when he hired Harvard professors, MIT professors, by saying the following. He knew about how to argue with them. Are you famous before the institution, or you're famous because you're brilliant men or women? I'm brilliant men and women. So why don't you move to Boston University if you don't need the institution? You don't need institutional crutches. Come to institution that you will be one of few, but important rather than one of many unimportant. And on one occasion, I won't mention the name, Harvard proposed somebody to get adjunct appointment, half-time appointment at BU and half-time adjunct at Harvard. He said, if that, she's that good, you give him tenure first, then we'll consider what to do here. And I've seen the Silber bringing Texas to Boston. Nothing can deter a Texan, he said. He wanted, in many ways, he became Texan in residence spiritually in Boston. And just Chelsea, which I was involved, when Annenberg wanted to give public grant to public schools, John Silber, imagine, in the middle of all of these competitions, and as nobody wants to touch K-12 education, he took the Chelsea school system against demonstration of parents and unions. Parents thought it's a power grab. And what did he do? He provided Boston faculty members to go and teach math teachers, science teachers. He provided dental care, eye care, and grandparents and parents of students received medical care, everything, and turned that poorest section, poorest school system, into one wonderful thing, thanks to John Silber. He went to prisoners thing, which was already there, I would not mention. But in all of these things, Silber had Immanuel Kant with him. And I'm glad that before he died, the book got published. This is the manuscript that was burned in the famous 1971 fire. John Silber's long anticipated Kant's ethics, the good, then freedom, and the will, was published. Kant had been a lifelong companion. He wrote, I fancy, I hope, with some plausibility that Kant would have been pleased with the interpretation of his ethics by me. As I always felt that he was peering over my shoulder, sometimes surprised, sometimes distressed, but for most part, nodding his approval. That was John's great triumph. At long last, Immanuel Kant, who had tortured him, been by obscure German interpretation, Dutch interpretation, all of the interpretations, all of a sudden was accepting John Silber as a disciple of his. Throughout his life, John tried to answer three basic questions that Immanuel Kant had put forth. What can I know? What ought I to do? And what may I hope? Those are three things that drive him. Education, in the realm of education and elsewhere. So because of time limit, let me just go my conclusion. Conclusion I have, that he was a passionate man. Passion came from Kierkegaard. He said, I hold with Kierkegaard that passion is first. It comes before everything else. A man without passion is not much of course. We want it to be civilized by reasonableness and rationality. But as between the reasonable man and the rational man, I prefer the reasonable one and fear the rational one. A reasonable man can have something he's damn sure irrational about it. Let me repeat again. A reasonable man can have something he's damn sure irrational about it. This prompted Ronnie Dagger, the Texas Monthly editor, to write the following about John. Now, he says, John, as a possibly rational, irrationally reasonable, a contradiction inside a paradox wherein finding himself trapped, John contrives to find his virtue in the middle of all of this. And then he described one day, this is typical John, you find a fault for him or with him and he'll have an excuse. He described me once as having innocence of a baby, integrity of saint, and political skills of Talleyrand. I said, for God's sake, Talleyrand was neither naive and so forth. If I'm all of that, so you contradict yourself. I'm entitled to make once in a while contradictions, he said, like Immanuel Kant. Anyway, John, I will tell you the play Sheridan, which was published 1799, The Critic, brought the number of those who undergo the fatigue of judging for themselves is precious few. Silber cherished, he wanted to double, triple, increase the number of those who will undergo the fatigue of judging for themselves. He was not afraid of opinions. He wanted worthy people to debate him. And I can tell you another thing you've not heard before. He read every tenure case manuscripts of the writers, authors, which department chairs had not read. So when you appear with him, you better be prepared. Anyway, I want to thank him because John Silber, in the words of Edward Young, who wrote in 1759, said, "Born originals, how comes it to pass that we die as copies?" John Silber was born original, lived original, and died original. In the process, I told him, my last word, that you're a candle. You're a candle for BU. You're going to make BU great. In the process, you're going to extinguish yourself. But in doing so, you leave a monument that always will remember that individuals count, leaderships count, and that Boston University will always be great. Thank you.
I think we see a theme emerging. When John's obituary appeared in the newspapers, I received a lot of emails, and interestingly, more than one shared a particular quote with me, and I suspect there's a reason for that. The passage is fairly well known. It's from a speech delivered by Teddy Roosevelt in 1910 at the Sorbonne, one of the first significant colleges of the medieval University of Paris. And it reads as follows. "It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes short again and again, because there is no effort without the error, and there is no effort without the shortcomings. But who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with the cold and the timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat." These words do speak to the public John Silber that you've heard about, but there was a private John, one that we all worked with. For me, it was 30 years. In fact, over the years, I would often be asked by friends and colleagues and strangers alike, "What's it like working for John Silber?" Not sure why they would ask me that. He was a consummate teacher, using every possible occasion as a teachable moment. He did this with students and staff alike, and always with me. As my teacher, he returned many a business memo, red-penciled, for grammar and composition errors, so much so that I signed up for English 101 again after I started working for John at Boston University. He enjoyed working with the faculty and deans. You've heard much of that. But he also enjoyed talking to the masons and the plumbers and the electricians and the ground workers and the custodians. And I recall going to his home for a barbecue where he had invited staff from the Buildings and Grounds Department and lots of kids were there. And he was barbecuing a lamb. And it was, as it was turning over the coals, the kids would come up to him and ask, "What is that?" Because they had never seen it before. And he kept telling them all afternoon that it was his old greyhound. He was a sort of source of great support to countless members of the faculty and staff, and some of us would say he was a soft touch. If it came to his attention that a member of the faculty or a staff member had a medical problem, he would do whatever was necessary to find the best medical attention. If a person experienced a financial setback, John would reach into his pocket unhesitatingly. If a personal family tragedy struck, John was there with unwavering moral support. In short, he did love helping others, and I'm sure his kindnesses will echo in this room. John and I worked together on the non-academic areas of the university on some very big issues that you've heard mentioned. But I worked on some small things too. Some of the small things don't seem to matter very much now, but they do reveal a man who had an endless capacity for details. And they also provide an insight into his good humor. He was passionate about creating a green and an urban, clean campus, initiating the planting of hundreds of trees, as you've already heard. In 1988, he wrote to me the following note. "Dear Joe, when I come to campus on Saturday mornings, this campus is filthy, literally filthy. We cannot wait until late in the day on Saturdays to clean up the mess. We undermine all of the good impressions made by Boston University during the week by the filth that covers this place on Saturdays and sometimes even on Sundays. Take a look at this and see what we can afford to do about it." Then he handwrote along the bottom, "First things first, don't put this ahead of the budget." Now, when I say he paid attention to details, let me just say that I personally enjoyed those Saturday walks through the university campus, watching him draw pictures and diagrams of trees so that he could instruct me on how to determine the proper pruning techniques. And in early March in 1987, he wrote to me, "Dear Joe, as I've walked around the campus, I've noticed that no work has been done on the trees. The new trees planted on Sherborne Street have many limbs that need to be removed before they begin to bud. The hedges have not been cut back. The other trees have not been trimmed. It is now March 1st, and the budding will begin momentarily." While John was extremely generous with others, he was also quite frugal, and he had an old electric shaver. I mean, a really old electric shaver that he had completely reconditioned. But he was afraid that it might fail in the future, and he just couldn't let it go. So in 1991, after some discussion, I wrote back to him, "Dear John, as you requested, enclosed with this note are the spare parts you asked me to order for you. I genuinely hope you don't misplace them before you actually need them. You owe me $23.74, which I promptly received." Now, getting back to the original passage, John was tenacious, original, and he had what I would call a white-hot passion for advancing Boston University. He was a doer of deeds. He did err sometimes again and again, but he had great expectations, and he had great enthusiasms, and he did spend himself in a worthy cause, and he did experience high achievement. And what was it like to, what was it like working for John Silber? Well, he had the high expectations, but he understood that we all err. Speaking for the many I represent, he was a teacher, mentor, supporter, most importantly, my friend. It was a lot of fun working for John. One of the best experiences of my life. Thank you.
I'm one of John's daughters. My name is Martha, and this is my son, Joseph, and we'd like to share a few words with you.
Mr. Chairman, President Brown, members of the board, thank you for hosting this memorial, and thank you for allowing us to share a remembrance of my grandfather, John Silber. While preparing for today, I was reminded of the last time I stood before a group like this, the family, the friends, the BU staff, the honored guests. It was the dedication of Silber Way on a beautiful spring day. It was so easy then to know what to say. But now he's gone. The cousins don't have anyone's back to sneak behind. My parents, aunts, and uncles don't receive any more annotated newspaper clippings or health advice in the mail. And there's an empty seat at Saturday dinner. And yet all of us still can hear his voice when we read his books. We can see his energy at this university. As a student myself at Boston University, first in high school at BU Academy, and then as an undergrad in the College of Arts and Sciences, I saw that his academic spirit and intellectual curiosity permeate this campus. His dedication to excellence is evident in the faculty, facilities, and physical space. As a family, we are blessed that Granddaddy exercised that spirit in everyday life. He taught us to sail. He taught us to speak. He even taught us how to make sangria. When I traveled with him to New York for his last meeting on the board of Mutual of America, we ended every day with a walk up Fifth Avenue to Rockefeller Center. He reminisced about coming to New York in the 1950s while studying at Yale to sell handbags wholesale on Madison Avenue. He told me about his first big sale to a department store. Proud and excited, he called my grandmother Catherine and asked her to meet him in the city. He wanted to celebrate. As it turns out, the store backed out of the deal. I expected an unhappy ending. I expected that academic spirit to give me a lesson in the logic or the simple economics of his position. But instead of turning around for New Haven when my grandmother arrived, they stuck to the plan and had a wonderful weekend in New York. The lesson wasn't academic, it was far more important. Take time to love and be loved, to commune with your fellow human, whether you had a good day or bad. Thank you.
What is it like having John Silber as your father? This is a question my siblings and I have been asked many times. What is it like? Of course, people are asking about the public, professional, Boston University John Silber. The part of Dad that we shared with BU was mixed. Sometimes it wasn't easy. Dad was often in the press in the early years with the unrest at BU, the protests, the burning of Dad's effigy in front of our house, and as the years went on, there was press coverage by many national magazines. 60 Minutes did a piece, the Boston Globe coverage. Often, the coverage was critical. And as kids, we didn't always understand that. And sometimes this part of Dad was amazing. We accompanied the public professional John Silber on some wonderful trips. We met fascinating people and had opportunities that I realized as an adult were not common to most people. I was always proud to be his daughter and proud of him. And as has been mentioned here, Dad didn't waver or change his stance because of the direction the wind blew. And growing up, as he did in his professional life, he embodied the idea of teachable moments way before the phrase was ever coined in educational terms. So the real answer to the question, since he was really the same man, both publicly and privately, at the core of him, but that answer boils down to who walked in the door at the end of the day. And it wasn't the John Silber we shared with BU. It was our father. 9 weeks ago today, we lost him. So we have to say goodbye to Daddy, Dad, Pop, Doc, Granddaddy, G-Daddy. He had many names to us, and he is missed. In his last months, Dad often said, "When I'm gone, don't cry for me. I've accomplished more goals than most people ever dream of having. I've had a wonderful life." Thank you.
Well-beloved, we all live in hope, hope that our books will have second editions, and hope in the promise of second editions for our lives. Houses not made with hands, eternal in the heavens, wherein the various inevitable typos may be resolved and remade. To the divine presence, to the freedom of grace, to the eternity of love, we now commend President John R. Silber. And we shall rise and depart this place, knowing that we too have work to do, things to do before the sun sets. May we with him have a measure of that rare combination of idealistic vision and pragmatic skill, that Lincoln-like blend of commitment to excellence and attention to detail, for we have our own work to do, and we shall do it. In words on our minds of late, we shall do it with malice toward none. We shall do it with charity for all. We shall do it with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right. And in that spirit of John Silber, we shall say, now he belongs to the ages, or now he belongs to the angels, or now he belongs to the ages and to the angels. Surely he belongs to both. Beloved, please join us following our musical benediction here for a time of fellowship in the hall just behind me.
Nobis Domine, Domine, nobis Domine, sed nomine, sed nomine tuo, da gloria.